Galaxy Zoo Zooniverse Project by Brenda Garcia and Oscar Pecino. Confession time. Let's get the obvious out of the way. Galaxy Zoo is not animals in space. My mind actually went there and ran a scenario that a space chihuahua was going to attack me in space. It would look like this. Our group's project consisted of classifying galaxies, stars, and its surroundings for the Galaxy Team Zoo site, which has been utilizing volunteers to assist for over a decade. Because of galaxy shapes are vital to the research and age, an inexperienced volunteer like us could help determine the intricacies of the galaxy's lives. Volunteers' classifications are especially important as the classifications and research being done helps the Galaxy Zoo team determine and comprehend the past, the present, and future of the universe as a whole. Several volunteers' classifications for each galaxy are being merged with computer classifications to help study interactions. The Galaxy Zoo project aims to answer a range of specific scientific queries, which is basically a hypothesis that people might have when they look at a galaxy, to organize and utilize the groundwork for morphological work, to produce samples of morphologically selected high redshift galaxies for follow-up using instruments like the extremely large telescopes and ALMA, Atacama Large Millimeter Array. Understand how the universe has developed into what it is today, basically giving it like a timetable. I guess you can call it the galactic calendar, and the use of galaxy shapes to decode the 13 billion years of galactic history. In 2019, Into the Zooniverse was published, providing insight on all the Zooniverse projects. The book states, since the inception of the Galaxy Zoo project, volunteers have assisted with finding a new class of galaxies, which is something that hasn't been done in a while, and finding evidence of past movement from a supermassive black hole. Galaxy Zoo statistics. We are a part of something huge. The 50 plus classifications minimum request for our course contribute to a larger scale research that makes a big difference for the Galaxy Zoo research team. We are proud to be a part of over 50,000 volunteers. As you can tell on this little chart, we have over 53,576 volunteers, over 1 million classifications, close to 2 million, 234,380 subjects, and 140,675 projects completed. So we're almost to the point where we're at the halfway point of this whole research thing, and we're actually a part of this. And it's quite interesting, and I feel honored. Using the field guide, we would classify galaxies and determine whether they had ellipticals, spirals, and other morphologies. The field guide provided great examples of the differences we were looking for. However, at times you would get dizzy in doing the same classifications as they started to look similar. The field guide provided many pictures to help determine the galaxies we were classifying. Each category helped with illustrations of each category during each step of the classification. As you can see here in this video, my classmate Brenda is actually doing one of the galaxies right now. She notices that it has a smooth surface, so she looks smooth, it's okay. She sees that it's an in-between shape, so that goes to the next one, and tries to find any other features that she might notice. Major disturbance, minor disturbance, she doesn't see any. And last but not least, she has to pick one of the other items that she might see. She thinks that there might be a ring, and she's debating on picking it, until she decides to do it. And then it goes on to the next one. So in this image, she's determining that she notices that it has a bulge in the galaxy. So she's trying to determine that and find it in the field guide. And she did notice something. It says the central bulge was either large or dominant. As a newbie to the site, you have to trust your gut and take your best educated guess. All in all, there is no wrong answers. The only thing that it can do is actually point you in the right direction. Sometimes the wrong answers can point you in the right direction. could also see in the images more examples of what she's doing. The dust that looked very similar to what is in the field guide helped to show that this could possibly be a star. As you can see on the in that image, on the first row, on the second image where the first red arrow you see, it looks similar to the image that she's looking at, which is on the left-hand side of the screen. The image is almost identical to what is in the field guide in relation to stars. Using the field guide to determine the majority of what was seen, she sees that it's smooth, completely round, with a minor disturbance, and with a ring around it. That's what she notices. So over time, she selected those choices and moved on to the next one. Okay, so these are the slides that I've done. Now, before I go into it, I know a little bit of fun facts about the galaxies, and not only that, I'm a huge fan of astronomy. So I will throw in a few fun facts every once in a while. That way, you know, you can learn something new. First fun fact, there are no green stars. So if you see a green star, go see your doctor because you might be having a stroke. Moving on. Now, this is the first image that I saw on the top left corner, and it says, when I wrote it down, I noticed that the image has something odd. It has a distinct feature in front of it. So basically, as you can tell, there's like a small little object in front of it. It did not look like a disc to me, so it must be something else. It doesn't have spiral patterns, and it shows to have a major disturbance in the galaxy. Fun fact number two. Every star you see in the night sky is bigger and brighter than our sun. Next galaxy. I noticed that the galaxy was smooth, as you can tell in the image onto your left hand side. Now, I also noticed that when using the field guide, you can see that the galaxy is shaped like a cigar. There's a smaller image to the right of the second image on the left hand side, as you can see. Those other examples are cigar-shaped galaxies, which is matching the one that I see on my end. In my opinion though, I think that there's a small orangish ring color within the galaxy. It's faint, but I noticed it. So if you really look at it carefully, it kind of gives like the illusion of it might be a orangish ring around it. Fun fact number three, our sun is a green star, so go see a doctor. Moving on to our last slide. The image looks somewhat normal until I noticed the image was slightly blurred. It looks smooth with no sign of a disc. And there seems to be a minor disturbance happening, which if you could look carefully in the image slightly above where that bright spot is, if you look above it, you notice that there's like a shadow going over it. And I feel like something might be colliding or actually getting in its way. So I looked up minor disturbance in the field guide, and it says the galaxy still has a recognizable shape. Unusual features are much fainter than the main galaxy and might be missed. So I actually found that there is a minor disturbance. Why are humans better at this than computers? Well, first point is, humans created computers. It's by design. We made it that way so we could be able to use it. The human mind can determine the classification quickly and can be compared to computers' classifications to give a greater outlook of the galaxies. So we could actually comprehend a lot faster than what the computer can give out as far as what we see and what the description is. Reason being is because you have to give computers that kind of coding in order for it to distinguish any features. Because without those, it's basically looking at nothing. Also, the human eye may be able to pinpoint items that the computer cannot. Even though that a computer can actually see way farther than we can, we have way more clarity when we're looking at an object. And human nature, we can tell what an object is, to where a computer will not know what a star is compared to a desk lamp. You have to program that into there. human eye may be able to pinpoint items that the computer cannot. What that means is we can see a lot clearer than what a computer can do. And not just that, even though computers can see farther than we can tell what we're looking at as soon as we see the object. A computer will not know the difference between a lamp and a star unless you program it to know what it is. And this is me talking here in this last point. Computers are dumb machines. They need us to tell them what to do. Trust me, I'm an IT guy. And here we have Brenda's reflections on the project. Point number one, the task was relatively easy as the field guide helped every step of the way. So in all honesty, like if we did not have that field guide, we would probably have been stuck for a good while and not know what we were doing. Point number two, the task was interesting as I became more familiar with it. In other words, practice makes perfect. Number three, I enjoyed finding unusual differences like stars forming in spirals. However, I did not enjoy the count of classifications not coinciding with the flow of how fast I was going. There is a lag in the counter. So I did notice that as well. It doesn't keep up with if you're going at a fast pace. So that needs to be updated because instead of you finishing the classifications, you're basically adding more workload because the computer cannot keep up. So in other words, computers are dumb machines. And the last point. When first working on the project, I thought you would be able to compare your classifications of the same galaxy with someone else's classification. I wanted to know I was doing it right. I did learn that unless other volunteers are adding hashtags or talking about the classifications, you will not know the other's thoughts. And I did also notice that as well. I kind of wish that was a feature where you could actually show off what you actually, you know, deciphered to other people. And from there, people can talk about, okay, this is what you saw, but this is what I see. And then you are engaged in a conversation about the galaxies and trying to figure out what is actually there. And her last thing that she had to say was, I had to learn to trust my gut. So basically, she just followed her instincts. And like I said earlier, there is no wrong answers. And here are my reflections on the project. Point one, the project wasn't really that difficult, but it was a little tedious to find the right galaxies to use. The reason why I say that is because I did not want to repeat the same galaxy that Brenda was using in the slides. So I had to actually find one, or find a few, that was slightly different from what she had. Point number two, I was lucky to be selected to be a part of the study of galaxies. As I mentioned earlier, I love astronomy. I love it, which made it way more interesting to me and actually that more humbled to actually look at these images. Point number three, seeing galaxies that not a lot of people have seen. So in other words, without me or Brenda, you will not see these pictures. So you're welcome. And point number four, I was surprised that the images were legible. All the images I have seen previously in other sites like Google or Bing or any search engine seem to have a pixelation problem. I really enjoy the project. The one thing I will give it is that because of this galaxy zoo, you actually see very clear pictures of galaxies, which is a achievement in itself because knowing how far these galaxies are is like light years away, and only to see glimpses of it and still decipher what it is. So for that, I am honored.
Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere. to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.